Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh and a very good morning. Welcome everyone. I am Noliza from CDAE and thank you for joining us for today's webinar. Kami mengharapkan semuanya sihat-sihat saja ya. This morning we are presenting Teaching and Learning in Applied Science. Let's be innovative. To talk about innovation in teaching and learning, we have all the way from Terengganu, Dr. Shariza Muhammad Sharif. Dr. Shariza ada kan? Kita tak nampak dia. Okay, apa khabar Dr. Shariza?
Dr. Shariza tengah cuba nak masuk. Kejap,
oh, saya tak nampak nama dia. Kita tunggu sebentar Dr. Shariza masuk.
Dr. Shariza masuk dah rasanya.
Okey. Assalamualaikum Dr. Shariza, dah ada dah masuk, dah berjaya masuk?
Assalamualaikum.
Okey. Okay. Okay, terima kasih Dr. Shariza. Apa khabar?
Baik-baik. Alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah. Terima kasih kerana sudi menerima jemputan kami. Ya. Rasa ni yang ni yang pertama kali kan?
Yang ni kira pertama kali. Ya. Terima kasih jugalah CDAE. Ya. Sudi apa ni? Jemput saya.
Kami yang lebih berterima kasih. So, jadi selamat datang ke CDAE dan mungkin USM lah ya. Mungkin. Okay. So, allow me to briefly introduce Dr. Shariza. Dr. Shariza Muhammad Sharif is a lecturer in the field of fish genetics at the Faculty of Fisheries and Food Sciences, University Malaysia Terengganu. He is currently the director for Center for Talent Development and Innovation, University Malaysia Terengganu. In teaching and learning, his focus is on the application of simulation-based learning and alternative assessment in fisheries and aquaculture. He has developed several teaching kits based on simulation-based learning, and one of the teaching kit called Fish Breed Pro has won first place in the Anugerah Pemikiran dan Reka Bentuk Semula Pendidikan Tinggi Malaysia 2017. So without further delay, I would like to welcome Dr. Shariza to conduct the webinar. Dipersilakan Dr. Shariza.
Okay, terima kasih ya Puan Noliza, Puan Dr. Noliza.
Puan Noliza.
Okay. Terima kasih Puan Noliza. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum and a very good morning to all of you participants. Those who are here, maybe professors, associate prof, doctors, ladies and gentlemen. So first and foremost, Alhamdulillah, thank you very much for your participation and presence. And also thank you very much to Center for Development of Academic Excellence, CDAE, and also Prof. Karim for inviting me to share some of the information regarding teaching and learning in applied science and looking into some of the innovative aspects of it. Okay. So before we start, just want to test something. Can you all listen to me clear? And also, can you see the slides?
Boleh dah, boleh.
Okay, terima kasih. Baik, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Rabbi syurahli sadri wa yasirli amri wahlun uqdatan min lisani yafqahu qawli. May Allah ease this presentation and the running of this session, and may we ask a blessing from Allah in the hope that He would give us the understanding, because only Allah has the power to give understanding to those that He wants, and we hope that everybody here would gain the understanding as from this sharing or from this talk. So the title of my presentation will be teaching and learning in applied science. Let us be innovative. And to start off, as well as you all know, I am Shahriza, a lecturer in fish genetics. Currently, I'm attached to Pusat Pembangunan Bakat, but my present office is at the Faculty of Fisheries and Food Science. So you can communicate and contact me through this phone number, through WhatsApp, Telegram, and also through this email, okay, shahriza@umt.edu.my. I welcome everybody, anybody would want to discuss. I would be very glad to receive any message from all of you. So what do I do actually? Now, as you all know, I'm a fish geneticist. I breed fish. Okay, and what I teach to students is on the breeding aspects that tries to improve the quality of the fish. So it can be in terms of colors, it can be in terms of the growth. So anybody here also is also a fish hobbyist. Yeah. So this is one of the, just to share with you some of the experiment and activities that I did. Okay. Breeding fish, crossing them. So actually, I considered myself as a fish wedding planner or matchmaker, right? Not Tok Bidan, but actually Tok Kadi. Eh? So you select the fish that has the desired character, just like all of you when you want to get married. I'm sure you have some criteria that you want to choose. So this fish that you presume to have a certain criteria, then you cross in the hope that these characters would be inherit or maybe combine and produce new characteristics to the siblings or the progeny. So in our field, this is part of applied science, and trying to explain to you what we are doing at the Faculty of Fisheries. We have three fisheries and aquaculture program. One diploma in fisheries, another one is a degree in fisheries and also degree in aquaculture. So here, as you can see, the student learns many types of skills. They learn about how to culture a fish, how to develop feed, okay, for the fish, how to manage the culture, and how to breed the fish for the purpose of production, and also how to nurse, because when you get when you breed, you have babies, you need to nurse them. They have certain food, certain condition that they need to be cultured. Now on top of that, they also learn about the fish biology, so similar to those medical doctors, yeah, who learn about the human anatomy. They also need to understand the anatomy of the fish, the physiological aspect of the fish. And apart from that, they also learn how to capture the fish. So some relationship about fisheries exploitation. So it's not to train them to become fishermen, but we have successful story of students who become fishermen, now owning about 7 fishing vessels, and very successful in Kuantan. But they experience this so that they know how the fish are being exploited and how to manage them. So a lot of outdoor activities going on with the student. And not only that, they also learn about fisheries management and how to conserve the fish. And students also focus on the downstream part. After you have caught the fish, or you harvest the fish that you culture, so how to process them. Either process it in terms of in a raw state, or you produce some other products from this fish. I've got the chance to become the evaluator in one of these fisheries product processing class, okay? And don't be surprised, they have the creativity to create various types of recipe, and some of them are being commercialized within among the UMT. So if you look into what we are doing, it is all about applied science. And I'm pretty sure USM also deals with a lot of academic programs, okay, related to applied science. Now, we know that the past 2 years, the challenge due to COVID pandemic forced us to think beyond this our limitation, thinking outside of the box, and also try to create something that allows us to still create a highly engaged learning activities to the student. So this is where creativity and innovation always comes into practice. So due to this, my content of presentation will be break into 5 parts. So before we see these activities or the practices in applied science, teaching and learning, so I would like to give an overview of creativity and innovation. Then we'll try to look into why we do innovation. And the third part, we look into how to innovate. And I will continue to show you some examples. And I hope also if some of you have, maybe you can share some of the examples of your innovation in teaching and learning. And then finally, we go to the summary. Now, we go to the first part. Okay, let's start the ball rolling. Creativity and innovation. Okay, let me stop this for a while because I think I didn't adjust the setting of sharing for sound. All right, this I would like all of you to watch this video. This is a 5 minutes video. It has got nothing to do with teaching and learning, but there's something behind it related to creativity and innovation. Now, I'll try to play. If you cannot, if you, please respond if you can hear the sound or if you cannot hear the sound.
Dengar, Doktor.
Boleh dengar?
Sini, cabang chop the football.
Oh.
Kan mak. Tapi mikir kau lah lo. Kau yang dihen. Lo kini on di bun nam. Mak tenen tenen leo. Kau di ni, mimi bunin sak ni. Kila yang dia ti leng kan dah kau keng rua. Mai kau mau kau lang kau si cap dai. Kau nan le, kau am kit lek lek kau kau kau. Pok lo, kit tang game football kau mak. ชาวบ้านพวกคิดว่าพวกเราบ้าเอ๊ะเด็กพวกนี้ส่งเสียงอะไรกันป้าเปิ้นหิมะเราแล้วตั้งทีมบ้านแล้วจะเป็นแชมป์โลกมีแต่ทะเลกันที่กับทีมตกมึกที่อย่างที่แกพูดพวกเราไม่มีแม้แต่ที่ให้เล่นฟุตบอลพอเราจัดทีมกันเสร็จปัญหาต่อมาก็คือเราจะเตะกันที่ไหนล่ะ ที่นี่มีแต่ทางเดินแคบๆแล้วเราก็มีความคิดว่าเราต้องสร้างพื้นที่ของเราเองเรารวบรวมเศษไม้เก่าๆผูกเข้ากับแพปลา ทำอย่างนี้ทุกวันหลังเลิกเรียนแล้วเราก็สร้างสนามของเราขึ้นมาหุ่นยกยีกแต่มีวัตถุปูเต็มไปหมดบนตกน้ำบ่อยมากเลยพวกเราด้วยแต่เราก็เรียนรู้ในการเล่นบนสนามแบบนี้ก็นี่แหละสนามของเรา
สนามนี้อาจจะเป็นแชมป์โลก
แล้ววันหนึ่งเราก็ได้ไปสมัครการแข่งขันฟุตบอลแล้วเราจะสู้กับเขาไหวเหรอแล้วเราก็ตัดสินใจลงแข่งถึงจะไม่มีชุดก็เหอะ
นี่แหละแชมป์ชุดนี้รออย่างแรง
เราไม่รู้มาก่อนว่าจริงๆแล้วชาวบ้านก็สนใจเราเหมือนกันพวกเขาเอาชุดมาให้แถมตามาเชียร์ด้วยตอนนั้นเราตื่นเต้นนะแต่พอเอาเข้าจริงเราทำได้ดีกว่าที่คาดไว้จังหวะเท้าของเราดีกว่าจากการเลี้ยงหลบตะปูแถมประตูในสนามจริงใหญ่กว่าตั้งเยอะแล้วเราก็เข้าถึงรอบ4ทีมสุดท้ายวันนั้นฝนตกหนักมากแถมคู่แข่งก็เป็นแชมป์เก่ารองเท้าของเราเต็มไปด้วยน้ำเราเล่นกันไม่ได้เลยหมดครึ่งแรกเราโดนนำไป2ลูกเราสู้ไม่ได้จริงๆเราไม่รู้จะทำยังไงหลังจากครึ่งแรกที่เราสู้ไม่ได้เราต้องทำอะไรบางอย่างเราต้องกลับไปเล่นฟุตบอลแบบของเราด้วยการถอดรองเท้ามันเป็นฟุตบอลแบบที่เราถนัดจริงๆคู่แข่งสู้เราไม่ได้เราเล่นดีขึ้นทำได้ดีขึ้นเราตีเสมอได้เราคิดว่าเราจะชนะเพราะลูกนั้นในนาทีสุดท้ายนั่นแหละแล้วไม่เสียใจหรอกดีใจซะอีกที่มาได้ไกลขนาดนี้แถมชาวบ้านทุกคนก็ภูมิใจด้วยหลังจากนั้นความคิดของคนทั้งเกาะก็เปลี่ยนไปวันนี้เรามีสนามใหม่ที่ไม่มีตะปูแล้วแต่เราก็ยังไม่ได้เล่นบนสนามหญ้าอยู่ดี
TMB เชื่อว่าพลังในตัวคุณเปลี่ยนโลกให้ดีขึ้น TMB Make the Difference
Okay, I hope the line is okay. This is based on a true story. In one province in Thailand, Pan Yi Football Club. Okay, let us go to... I'm not using any Mentimeter or Padlet, but I'm using Google Jamboard today. There is a reason, but I will explain later as we progress. Now, I give you the link. Now, please share your thoughts. What can you see from here in relation to innovation? And what are your views and your comment? So, let me share you the link so that you can... Okay, I give you the link to Jamboard. Let me stop sharing this first. I share you with this. Okay, for those of you who aren't familiar with Jamboard, if you want to write, you can use these sticky notes here. You just click and then write it up, your comments on what you want to type. Or you can put a text. There's a square with a T. So then you can just put the text here. I will create some more frame. We're going to have about, I think, two activities using this. Okay, let me see your thoughts about the videos. And if you want to just write up in the chat, please do so. Or you can just straight away voice up. You just unmute and just inform me. Okay. So when there's a will, there's a way. Open your mind, wherever you are, to bring innovation. Okay. One comment: innovation comes from people's need. That means there are some issues, some things that you need to solve. Innovation, yes. Thank you very much. The innovation part you can see here is the football playing field, right? It was never there, but they managed to create a football field, okay, a floating one, okay, at the sea, right? Very innovative, okay? Now, innovation has the potential to make a new reality free of the laws and constraints of the old world, okay? A new world where the only law is human desire and science. Yeah, that's good. Make it, just do it and improvise. Teamwork. Okay, yeah, just one comment. Being innovative, design thinking. I'm sure you followed Mr. Chua Kiman yesterday's talk. Regarding on design thinking, that is part of the strategy on how you're going to innovate. I will touch lightly at the second part regarding design thinking. Okay, just be yourself. The boy used to play kaki ayam, then they try to adapt because they have used to play on a wet playing field. So once the situation arises, they adapt to it, they change. Okay. And most of the thing, enjoy. You see, enjoy the time together, not thinking of others. Because if you notice that the video, initially some of the villagers think negatively about them. Togetherness. Yes, you need to be creative and innovative to achieve your target. See, creativity come in a non-stress situation. Even with limitation, we can make use of the resources, of course. You can see how they don't need high technology things, but they try to figure out what are the things available around them that they can use to create that playing field. See? And yes, there's another one, a good point. Hardship leads to creativity and innovation because they don't have any facilities. Okay? They don't have any facilities. They were not provided with all those. But that sparks their ideas on how to create things. Of course, experience are the best gurus. Yeah, based on experience. I saw some inside the chat. Let me read. By Dr. Kamarul, innovation kadang-kadang datang secara tak sengaja berdasarkan pemerhatian dan keperluan. Kalau plan awal, kadang-kadang tak menjadi sebab tak berpijak di realiti. So, sometimes bila ada sesuatu perkara yang perlu diselesaikan, nak kena solve juga, benda nak kena buat, that is why sometimes the innovation comes. Is there any dekat second? Okay. Alright, thank you very much for all the response. So you can see what I can summarize in that video. They created something. Okay, the floating football playing field using all the resources around them. But if you reverse back a little bit, the creation comes from the idea. Okay, they have the idea that they want. They have the common goal. We want to play football. Okay, we want to become champion. They have a target. And then they realize there are some issues. So they discuss. They think about it. They have the idea of to create the football playing field. But not only just having the idea, they act upon the idea. And the result, if you can see the results, initially, the football playing field is not that excellent, right? They mentioned that there are some nails sticking out. And also, the woods is not that even. But if you notice at the end of the video, there is another type of football field, which is much more better. So that is what we can say as the continuous improvement that they have done. Or maybe they have gained some funds based on their excellence in winning. But trying to solve it, and they are eager, the aim to become champion. Okay? Initiate them to create that, and they really play, and most important thing, they enjoy playing, like some of you mentioned here. Okay, they enjoy playing it, even though when they played, most of the time the ball went out of the field and goes into the water, but they don't complain. Okay, they don't grudge, but they enjoy it playing, and little that they know, they adapt to another situation in which playing and controlling in a very wet and slippery pitch. Okay, and they adjusted to the small goal, but now when they play to a bigger goal, it's very easy for them to shoot. Okay, and there's one more comment. You hate haters, but the haters then finally love you. Because why? They don't have the similar goal, the similar vision. But then when they start to see your determination, your motivation, your commitment, then they can start to realize the potential out of it. Okay? So this is what, to give an overview, what is innovation? The creating or the creation of something new, okay, from nothing to something. All right, okay, we're going to go back to Jamboard after this, but I proceed with so based on the video, coming to think of it, innovation is the successful introduction of a new thing or method. Okay? Or in one other reference, it is a method to produce new and better product or services. So the key word here is not only product, It can be a method. A method can be an innovation. A services can be an innovation. And in another aspect, it is a process by which a domain, a product, service is renewed. That means, in another perspective, it does not mean that you need to create something new, but an improvement of what you are currently doing. Okay? A domain, product, or service is renewed, okay, and brought up to date. So you're making something up to date, relevant to the current situation by applying new processes. Okay, the most simplest thing, if we relate to the or the online learning last time, previously we do face to face, but now you apply new process, even though that is an old application, Zoom, WebEx, Google Meet, but in your particular case, you are transforming, apart from giving face-to-face physically, but now applying new processes, okay, using Zoom video conferencing, okay, or you are introducing new techniques, establishing new ideas, and the purpose is to create new value. If you look into the Latin word, it comes from innovare, that means to renew. So, as some of you have commented, it is thinking outside of the box, looking beyond what we are currently doing, okay, yeah, develop ideas, and it helps us to do our job in a new way. So, we are trying to create new things, creating a transformative effect. So, as you can see, creativity is thinking up new things. Innovation is doing these new things. So before you innovate, you need to have an idea. So you can look at this the video just now. Based on the problems or issues, challenges that they face, they come up with an idea to build up a floating football field. But having an idea is not enough. That is where the creativity comes in. You have the idea, but without any action, there will be no new product, process, or method. And innovation is related to the action of creating the things that you have thought of. So in relation to creativity and innovation, the creativity is the use of imagination, the use of ideas. Okay, you have something crops up in your mind that you want to do something. Okay, but innovation is you are acting upon it, producing the result. Now, the result can be a product, service, or process. So, creativity relates to the imagination. It cannot be measured because how do you measure things that have the idea that inside your head? Okay, it is not being jelmakan, it's not being brought up physically into a tangible product. But innovation is related to the implementation. So when you create something, these things can be measured. So innovation comes after creativity. So creativity will develop new ideas, new solution, new alternatives. But innovation will act upon these ideas, upon this solution, upon this alternative. So, for example, okay, I have the idea of building up a football field. Okay, how to do it? Okay, we try to see having use of some of the resources that is available. So when it comes into the action part, okay, let's do it. Search for all those the wood boards, okay, who can buy the nails, okay, where to build these things. When you start to act upon the ideas and producing something, this is what innovation is all about. But is it enough to be called innovation? Nope, because in order to for you to call this is very innovative, there are some other things that you need to put into. So there are three major steps in innovation. The first thing is you need to have the idea. You act upon the idea, the implementation. Then you will see the outcome. That is the impact of it. And hopefully in education, it improves the learning quality. So to give you a concept, okay, to have an idea, so generally, you need to get this idea from somewhere, all right? So the input can be on the feedback, either the feedback from your students, feedback from your friends, your colleague. It may also be from analysis. You conduct a survey. From there, you analyze the data and see where are the gaps. Okay, how does the student perform? So based on your analysis, you see that, okay, there are some areas that you need to improve. Or sometimes, you have colleagues like just like the boys in the video. You have passionate academicians who are eager to try new things. So you sit down together at a coffee shop, okay, cafe. You discuss, brainstorm, coming up with ideas. Now, this is where the creativity part. But then the innovation comes in when you act upon the idea. So this action will produce a product. In education concept, it can be teaching kids or teaching aids. It can be software, application, apps. It can be method, okay? The teaching and learning approach, you develop new method or technique or some of the learning process where the student needs to experience them in order to gain the acquired knowledge. This is what I'm trying to highlight. When you want to say that you are doing innovation, the most important thing to declare that this is an innovation, it must have an added value. It must have an impact. Okay, whether the increment of in the student performance, improvement, okay, in their skills, or changes in their attitude or behavior, but not changes on the negative way, but changes towards the positive way. They are more skillful, they become highly motivated, not only 100% attendance, maybe 200% attendance, you get the interest of other students who would sanggup forget about the other class and attend your class because it is so not only interesting, but the way the teaching and learning occurs allows them to gain the knowledge that they wanted to learn. But if you want to see the impact, you cannot run away from seeing its effectiveness. So this is where research comes in. You need to do research to measure or to assess whether the ideas that you have transformed into a product really has an impact, okay, to the intended goals that you want. Okay, so we are talking about innovation and what are the output of educational innovation? Now, it can be a new teaching method. Okay, I give you one example. In 2017, there is one lecturer in a university. They won an award in innovation for creating a new teaching method in medical doctorate program. So what they did is like this. To learn about something, first and foremost, the first 20 minutes, the student needs to answer a question, okay, alone, individually. So they'll try to answer without looking at the notes. After 20 minutes, they need to group together. They are divided into groups and they are given 20 minutes to try to find one correct answer. During this session, the process of learning occurs in such a way that arguments crops up, because some students say that this is the correct answer, whereas the other students say that no, this is more accurate. So argument, discussion comes in, but the target, the aim is each group must come up with one correct answer for each question that has been given. And the next 20 minutes, each group need to present their finding. So this method of teaching has won an innovation award in Singapore in 2017. So this is what I meant by new teaching method. So it does not need to be production of a product that can be commercialized. It can be also in a new teaching method. Another one is improvement of existing product. You may have a certain products that you have developed, but you improve further. Maybe you add in some technology. Previously, that the things that you have, you added up, for example, virtual reality or augmented reality inside it, okay, where the student learn a little bit the different. Okay, so innovation can be there, because the keyword here is doing things out of your normal. Other than that, the creation of new instructional tools. This is where it can create a product. For example, teaching kids, you develop an apps, a software, and also a teaching module. Okay? Afterward, we try and see how to come up with a new teaching method. All right? Thank you for the question. So another one is the new learning process. I forgot to delete this, just copy and paste. Okay. This is looking into the learning theories aspects of education. Now, when you see the output, you can classify the innovation based on two things. One is incremental innovation. That means you are not producing new things. You are just improving what you have done. Okay. As I told you just now, maybe you have created something, but now to make it relevant to the current needs, you adjust something, add some process, add some new techniques inside there. If you have done it, that is also considered an innovation. So a lot of people sometimes they got confused, because they thought that innovation must come up with a product, must be commercialized, must have IPs, and must have patents or copyright. Now, it does not necessarily be like that. Okay? The basic concept is doing things out of your normal, and it depends on the stages of the innovation. It might be new to you, but it may be norm to the others, but it's okay, because what I'm trying to highlight here is innovation to improve teaching and learning, and not innovation for the purpose of winning a competition or award. Because if you are trying to win an award or competition, there are certain criteria that they want to see. But now we are focusing on improvement in teaching and learning using innovative method. So the incremental innovation can be based on CQI. Now, radical innovation, that means if you develop new things, new products that has never been existed before, okay, then that is considered as a radical innovation. So this normally comes up from explorative research. Now, I would like to come up with this one. Okay, how can I come up with a new teaching method? Now, in order for you to come up with a new teaching method, you cannot run away from understanding what are the current teaching methods that you have. Okay, so you need to do some literature search. Okay, you need to, apart from looking at some literature search, you need to also Google around, because some of the innovative strategies are being shared in blogs, okay, in some of the personal website. But the keyword here is you need to have the knowledge in teaching and learning. Okay, what are the knowledge that you need to have in order for you to come up with a new teaching method? Things like learning theories. Okay, for example, constructivism learning theories, behaviorism learning theories. What other, another thing? Connectivism learning theories, social learning theories. So you need to understand them, okay, in order for you to see how can you tune or adjust or modify what you have. That's one thing. Another thing is you need to look into, you need to understand into the learning strategy or learning type, if I'm not mistaken. Things like, are you doing simulation-based learning, problem-based learning, okay, collaborative learning? So you must have that knowledge first, okay? I always like to share this. When we want to teach, we must understand that you need to have two different knowledge. One is the knowledge on the content of the things that you want to deliver. That means your field of expertise. This is where you create the content, the syllabus, to transfer the knowledge to the students. But the second knowledge that you need to have is the knowledge in teaching and learning. So the knowledge in teaching and learning, as I said just now, in terms of learning theories, the learning strategies, okay, understanding how learning works, okay. I still remember Prof. Karim last time, I think last year, introduced his book, okay, 25 Ways for a Student to Think or to Learn. So you need to have all those knowledge. Based on that knowledge, then only you can start to be creative. So it goes back to, if you can remember, Bloom taxonomy. We have 6 levels. The top one is creating. The lowest level, okay, order thinking, starting from knowing. So you need to know, you need to understand how it works, you must apply it, then only you can experience, okay, whether it works or not. You evaluate. Now, when you have gone through all these processes, you know, you understand, then only you can think of how to be creative in creating the teaching method that you want to develop. Just like I shared with you the one that won an award for innovation in Singapore. All right? I hope I answered your question. Okay, we're going to go a bit more. Now, how do you assess your innovation? Basically, innovation is assessed based on 3 aspects. One is the novelty. That means the state of the product or the method or the process. Is it totally new? Has not been created before? That is novelty. Originality is the origin of the ideas. Okay? Sometimes the product can be new, but the originality of the idea does not come from you. Okay, what does it mean by this? Now, I give you an example. You have the idea. Okay, just look at that video I showed to you. These boys, they have the idea of we need to create a playing field. Okay? When they have that idea, They plan out what are the things that we need. They go and search for all those materials. They develop themselves. They build themselves. That means the originality of the idea comes from them. They created that thing as well. So this, what we can say, is very original or high originality. Now, there is a difference between this. You have the idea, okay, we need to build up a playing field. So you contact a company, excuse me, Mr. So-and-so, we have the idea of creating a playing field. So can you help us to develop this playing field? You didn't give any instruction. What are the things that you need? And then the company will say, okay, let me think of it, and we'll try to develop, to create something for you. So the original idea, yes, you said that we have the idea of building up a playing field, a football field. But you don't give any things. We want him to be like this. We want the component to be like this. All those thinking and development are being done by that person, the Mr. So-and-so. So, initial idea may be yours, but the construction, the build-up of that thing is not originally coming from you. So, things that have been created may be novel because it has not been created before, but even though the original idea is from you, but the originality of that creation is not from you. And that can be considered as low originality. Unless, like, you look at the boys, that can be considered as high originality. They have the idea, they execute, they were the one who searched for the materials, they were the one who thought of that the things, and they created it. And the third part is assessing the potential. Okay, this is where you see whether improvement has been made, student attained the intended learning outcome, whether you cut any cost. Okay, you shorten the time. Previously, it will take about 10 weeks to acquire that knowledge, but you develop new teaching method in which they can learn within 3 weeks. So you have shortened the time for the student to acquire the skills and knowledge. So this is what is meant by potential effect or impact. Okay, now we are going to take a 5 minutes break for a while. If you have any question, please ask me anything. Please put up in the chat or maybe in the Jamboard. I'll be happy to attend. But in the meantime, we'll try to have a short break. We'll see back at 10:30. Is that okay?
Okay, doctor, no problem.
Okay, all right. Thanks.
We will resume at 10:30.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
Here's to the ones that we got. Cheers to the wish you were here, but you're not. Cause the drinks bring back all the memories of everything we've been through. Toast to the ones here today. Toast to the ones that we lost on the way. Cause the drinks bring back all the memories. And the memories bring back you. There's a time that I remember when I didn't know no pain, when I believed in forever. Now my heart feel like December when somebody say your name. Cause I can reach out to call you, but I know I will one day, yeah. Everybody hurts sometimes, everybody hurts someday, yeah. But everything gonna be alright, gonna raise a glass and say, yeah. Here's to the ones that we got. Cheers to the wish you were here, but you're not. Cause the drinks bring back all the memories.
toast to the ones here today. Toast to the ones that we lost on the way. Cause the drinks bring back all the memories. And the memories bring back
Okay. So let us continue back. But before I proceed further, so do you have any questions or any thoughts or comments
Anyone would like to share?
Okay, if not, then I continue with this, and then we will have some again a small discussion just to get your views. But I go first into this the second topic. Now, why do we do innovation in teaching and learning, especially in applied science, as you can see? So you know that we have diverse learners, okay? These people having different characters, the current ones, even the future ones will change, will be different, okay? What they experience when they grow up, the technology that they are exposed, okay, will keep on changing, and they experience new things, right? So you need to cater all these diverse learners and their learning styles, right? And changes in required skills. Previously, I think Dr. Tazlizan also shared regarding the need. Okay, I'll give you the slides, and also I'll share to you the links for the link. I'll share the links with the Uru Setia. Okay, welcome, Dr. Lee. So, if you look into World Economic Forum and you trace back, starting 2015, 2020, 2022, 2025, you can see there are differences in terms of the ranking of the required skills, future skills. So, you need to keep abreast so that we are trying to prepare the students to have these skills to enable them to face, okay, the future. And I think you have already exposed to a lot of talks that say that we are preparing students for the jobs that has not been created yet. Okay, that is the challenge for all these educators, and also the challenge to all these students. Another thing, development in technology. Previously, if you notice, maybe 20 years ago, we don't have WebEx, we don't have Zoom. Okay, most of the time, some of them we use, Skype. Okay, 8 years ago, 10 years ago, maybe a lot of us use Skype, but now with the advancements of technology, you have a lot of software or apps for video conferencing. And not only that, where with the IR 4.0 comes in, a lot of technology comes in. You have IoT, you have drones, you have virtual reality, augmented reality. So this technology can be leveraged, okay, to improve student learning. And also adapting to the need and changes in education. I think USM is also similar to what UMT and other universities are facing. KPT currently now has trying to implement what we call as the four types of education: the POIS, SULAM, Excel, okay, research-based education, outcome, competency-based education. So these changes of curriculum. So we need to think of how we are going to adapt, we are going to change the way we teach to suit the need of this intended curriculum. And last but not least, RISE, Excel. If you look last time during the pandemic in MQA advisory note, so they also suggest that, you see, bagi kursus-kursus yang bercirikan technical, clinical, kerja makmal, most of them are applied science. Even though I know basic science, fundamental science like biology, physics, also have lab work, okay, atau lain-lain aktiviti yang melibatkan keperluan kompetensi kemahiran spesifik, dinasihatkan untuk secara kreatif dan berinovasi merangka kursus-kursus yang disokong dengan aktiviti praktikal atau amali, okay, so on and so forth. So the need to be creative and innovative. So innovation in education, if you look at the aims of innovation in education, is intended to raise the productivity and efficiency of learning, okay, and or improve learning quality. Now, some of you might not agree with me, okay? I see innovation in education a slightly different things compared to innovation in the scientific research. Because in scientific research, even though you need to raise productivity, efficiency, but if you notice, most of them are focusing on IPs, patents, commercialization. Okay? Innovation in education can also focus on that, because when you develop new things, you need to patent them, you need to have copyright. Okay? And some of the things, I don't deny, you can commercialize your teaching kits. Okay? But the real aim is to raise the productivity and efficiency of the learning. This is the aim of the innovation in education. Now, I will share to you afterwards one article in 2017. It's a good article related to innovation in education. So how to innovate? Okay, let us start, Tuni. Now, I would appreciate if a participant can give a comment or respond in the Jamboard. What are the issues that you see, you face, or you know in relation to teaching and learning in applied science? We will start off with issues. Yeah, I would appreciate if you can share the issues based on your perspective in applied science teaching and learning. Right? We'll try to discuss this, and then we go further with how to innovate in the focus of applied science. You can give your views in chat. Okay. You can also unmute and give your views, and also you can put inside your Jamboard. Okay, let us see this, because as you know, and if you look into the videos, you do things because there are some issues that you need to solve, okay? We have one here now. Students have been complaining that they have burden in accomplish assignment. Okay? That is one thing, especially during not even during online learning, even face-to-face, also students have been complaining. Yes, this is one issues. Trying to make the students understand that applied science as a field is still subservient to the imperatives of finance and technocratic dictates in the 21st century. Yeah. Because they don't see in the... applied science, if you can see, even though it is in relation to dollars and cents, but they still could not see it in that figure. How does this applied science can be converted into dollars and cents? Okay, students get demotivated if they don't have clear idea of the application of subject they are learning. This is one issue, right? When they are unclear, they will get easily demotivated. And that is where you can see the drop in the student engagement, even in the student attendance or in the student response to any activities, assignment that you give. Okay, fundamental courses which have a lot of infos to be delivered rather than application. Okay, now these are another issues. So, is this because, may I know if you can give me some feedback, is it because it's a required to ensure that the content is being, needs to be delivered, all these contents need to be delivered, or is it because of something else in relation to this? Time constraint, yes. Okay, another issue, time constraint. Totally agree. Applying the idea to real world would require facilities. If you want the student to experience, yes, you have the facilities they are able to do. Even if they are able to do during their learning, the real thing that has been done by the industries or by the agencies. Okay, for mathematics and statistics, it is hard for students to discuss among them on the reasoning for each steps of the proving. Okay, so thank you for your response. We can see that out of this response, what I can summarize. But before that, let me check, is there anything in the chat? Okay. Before that, again, testing. Is the sound okay? Do you have any sangkut nak?
Loud and clear, Dr. Sharissa. Right.
Thank you. Now, I can see that if you can summarize the issues, one of them is student motivation. Okay, one. Second, time. Okay, if we can summarize time. A lot of things, there are contents. Okay, I combine this content and time. A lot of things that you want to deliver, but time constraint. Time can be in terms of the semester, the duration, or time can be because the student needs time to grasp the knowledge that you delivered. So sometimes things that can be learned within 2 weeks, but actually because of the student characters or their ability, we need to stretch to 4 weeks, for example. So this is another thing, because there are some things that they need some time to acquire that knowledge. So time can be due to the student's learning abilities and due to the content, right? Behavior, student motivation, facilities, okay? We need facilities if we were to do, because this applied science is not, it's not a conceptual education, it's not a theoretical education, even though some of the things are based on theories, but you need facilities. As you can see in my case, for example, in fisheries, we need fishing vessels, we need some experiment location that we have. We are grateful to have Pulau Bidong, Kenye Lake, and then we have another one. Tanah Benjah, Setiu Wetland. Okay, so you need space areas where the student can experience things. Yes, attitude. Okay, and adapting, like this one, trying to make students understand that applied science is a field, okay, to this technocrat. So preparing the students, convincing people that the applied science is important so that you can have the required funding to have the facilities, to have the equipments, the chemicals, all those required things that you need to teach. Okay? And due to facilities, challenges in conducting practical or clinical teaching. All right, thank you very much. So these are the issues, right? And I can see that it aligns with what I have put up. So as you can see, the facilities, the time and the cost, because in order to have the facilities, you need money, the risk, right? The student changes in their behavior, they become demotivated. And then sometimes due to the lack of certain things, we need to give assignment and the load of the assignment sometimes demotivates the student. And the other one is creating content that's like what one of the participants gave the idea, his thought or her thought. So how do you develop content? You know that you have massive content. The student needs to learn. Okay, how to be creative in developing content in which maybe you need not to deliver one by one, but you let them to explore. I still remember Prof. Kalim always told us, less is more. Okay, how more time for the student to explore the content rather than you spending a lot of time to deliver the content, but in an effective manner in which the student are able to acquire that. So we started off innovating by thinking of these issues. So just now we do some initial brainstorming, as I can say. We didn't discuss yet the solution. All right. Now the second part while I'm going here, if you're able to give your comments of view, what are the solutions that you think needs to be done? If you can put it on the third page. Okay, while I'm going through several slides here, but if you can put some of your comments on the third Jamboard slide. Okay, what are the solutions that you think should be done? Okay, because as I told you just now, based on the framework, in order for you to innovate in teaching and learning, especially in applied science, it started off with trying to think of what are the issues and trying to think some ideas on how to solve it. You may not have an idea on creating something, but we started off with having some ideas to solve this thing. So if you have, please do so while I'm going go through a few slides over here. Now, what you are going through discussing this in the Jamboard, I give you just a glimpse on the activity that you do for design thinking and creative thinking. I'm sure Mr. Chua has already dwelt this very detailed yesterday morning. So generally, when you innovate, you have two ways that you can do. One is the design thinking approach. Another one is the creative thinking approach. So again, as you can see, to innovate, you also need knowledge how to innovate. This is also to reiterate back the question just now, how do I develop new method? So you need to have the knowledge, ilmu. You want to innovate, also you need knowledge on how to innovate. So design thinking, I won't go in detail, but there are a few steps. The first thing is you need to understand. So this is what we are trying to do just now, trying to see what are the issues. Okay, we are trying to look what are the needs of the students. So focus on the human-centered. And then you're trying to define solving issues or problem. This is the second state that I ask participants to see what are the things that or ways to solve the issues. And then you generate the ideas and solution. When you have the idea, act upon the idea and develop a prototype. When I say prototype, it does not mean a product. It can mean a prototype in terms of your teaching method. And you need to test. And from this testing, you keep on improving. Now, creative thinking process is a little bit different. You still generate ideas. You still need to understand what are the issues and how to solve them. But the difference between creative thinking and design thinking is that normally there is a stage where you incubate first the idea. You don't straight away or quickly act upon the idea. So you have some idea, you just incubate them, perum, few days or maybe one or 2 weeks. But that idea is actually working in our subconscious mind. So you think and think, suddenly you will have this, the third part where you call it illumination. So in a very simple term, aha thing that you have. Yes, I think I know how to solve it. Yes, this is the thing that we need to do. So the purpose of incubating is to have it, figure it out properly, so that once you get the idea, you are confident and you can say that yes, this is the idea and the way forward that we need to go. Because you know that sometimes I can give an analogy. If you are angry, that's why some people say that cool down, because during when you are angry, sometimes the word that you speak, you don't mean it. Right, but because of at that time you were very angry, some words that you shouldn't have said will come out. Okay, so that's why I say that, okay, you need to cool down first, take a deep breath. Okay, so the same here, you have some issues, you have some problems, you think that this is some of the ideas that I can use, but wait first, hold on, okay, incubate that idea. Okay, trust me, because I've gone through this this experience. Then you get something. This is the way to go. Then you start to develop, you evaluate, and you verify. So this is what we call as creative thinking process. So it's a bit different from design thinking, but I can say that it is very highly similar. Okay. So before we go to have a proper 10 minutes break, because after this, I will share to you my experience on going through all this in the hope that you can get some ideas, okay? How innovation is implemented in teaching and learning, especially in applied science, in my courses. Okay, but before we go to have a 10-minute break, now let me look back inside the chat. Sorry, not the chat. We go and see this. Okay. So, please do so if you have any things that you think that, okay, this is the way to solve it. It may not be the most, what I can say, correct one. It may not be the most effective, but to start off, you may have something crops in mind. Now, while some of you might want to give your views, okay, related to how to solve this, just to spark your idea. Now, let me see in the chat if you can respond inside the chat. Anybody of you knows about Roblox? Okay, I don't know whether you play or not, but normally it's being played by kids, children. Have you ever heard about Roblox? Anybody who have heard? Yes, huh? Okay. Is there anybody else? Yes, online game, yeah. Dr. Sakina, Dr. Kong has already ni. Those who have kids and you have your kids play Roblox, you know how I cannot say stress, but how challenging it is to ask your children to study, because the game is so interactive, so involving, and there are a lot of games inside there, okay, in which they are mesmerized by it. They keep on changing. Sometimes they can play together with their friends. Okay, let's see some more. Ah, yes. Okay, YouTube had demo on how to play. Now, why I highlighted Roblox? Now, my kids also play Roblox, but I really need to control them, because they can really play from the morning until evening. Those who know about this will know the challenges, especially during the PKP, right? When the school children needs to do things online. But what I want to highlight here, to spark your ideas. When you know that children really like to play that, they don't like to sit around, listen, like what I'm doing right now, okay? Don't you ever think that if you can work out with Roblox and create something inside there, students learn about what you are trying to deliver through game-based learning inside Roblox? Okay? If you're able to do that, that is one innovative way. Okay? They work together. They can team up together. You can create a learning instruction inside there. Okay? I give you an example. My children played how to build up an empire, a pizza empire, sushi tycoon, they play. So they learn from there how to build a business. So what are the things needed? There are stages. Based on that stage, they know that, okay, how many people you need to acquire to do business on pizza? What are the facilities that you need? Because they try to target to attain that facilities in order to run. The more facilities that they develop, they gain, the more the business will flourish. They are also on, they call it, I can't remember, where they build up a shopping mall. So they need to figure out what are the stalls, the shops that needs to be there to entice people. So when I look at it, there is something that we can leverage using that online game. But if only we could develop this game based on our subject, it can be some worth trying and see whether it is really effective for the students to gain the knowledge through that way. All right? So any comments on if you can share? In terms of what do you think on how to solve this based on your views here, right? You know that facilities, the time, the cost, okay, the student attitude, their behavior. So you have any, just put it inside there. Okay, and while waiting, if you can respond, if I may know, what are the subjects you are teaching in applied science right now? You can just respond in the chat, yeah, so that I have some ideas on what is the subject that are being taught by participants who are joining this session today. Okay, geophysics. Dr. Yasir. Oh, interesting topic. Clinical pharmacy. Oh, this is on medical pharmacy. Yes, yes. USM has pharmacy. Medical physics. Computer science, okay. Right, statistics, dietetics. All right, chemical engineering. Okay, medicine. Wow, this is so interesting. Robotics. Dr. Abdul Sattar, robotics, may I know which program having this robotic subject? Okay, mathematical engineering. Oh, mechatronics program. Okay, School of Engineering. AI, wow, this is all new. Very interesting. Artificial intelligence, bioprocessing. Wow. AutoCAD, okay. Flight performance. Ooh. Biotechnology and bioinformatics, all right. Flight performance, Dr. Chang or Prof. Chang, is it inside aviation program or inside engineering program? Flight performance. Aerospace engineering. Now, this is very interesting. When I look at all these subjects, I can see there are a lot of ways to innovate our teaching and learning. Engineering, calculus, statistics, data mining. Okay. Finite element modeling for highway. All right. Science forensic. Okay. A lot of problem-based learning can be adopted. All right. Okay. Thank you very much for your response. Now, before moving further, I will show you one example based on my experience implementing innovation in my subject, that is genetic and stock manipulation, part of applied science. But before that, I think I would like to suggest we take another 5 minutes break, okay? Then hopefully that we can take some rest and we can see this, because this is very, very focused. And hope that after the break, we can see very clearly how the implementation using all those things that I've mentioned previously being implemented. And I was hoping that through this sharing, you can see where is this the radical innovation comes in, where is the incremental innovation comes in, and what are the impacts that has been achieved based on this implementing innovation in this subject. Okay, so we take a 5 minutes break. We'll come back maybe about 11:10. Now it's about 11:06 or 11:05. Okay.
Okay, Dr. Shariza. All thank right. you.
Okay.
Now there's a good day, brought a bad good day, play me close. Cause girls like you run around with guys like me to send out. When I come through, I need a girl like you, yeah, yeah. Girls like you love funny, admit to the hour. When I come through, I need a girl like you, yeah, 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 yeah. Sink or swim. Whoa, don't,
you worry, I'll be there whenever you want me. I need somebody who can love me at my worst.
At my worst.
No, I'm not perfect, but I hope you see my worth.
See my worth.
'Cause it's only you, nobody knew I put you first. And for you, girl, I swear I'd do the worst.
Okay, so we continue back again. Yeah, here I would like to share with you my experience of doing this and hope that you can see and get some ideas on how you can start to innovate. But I'm pretty sure some of you already started something. Okay, but for those who haven't, to give you a clue. Okay. Now, one of the subjects that I teach is genetic and stock manipulation. So this course provides basic knowledge about the genetics and how genetics can be used in breeding program to improve certain traits or quality of the fish. Okay, and one of the learning outcome that I focus is at the end of the course, students will be able to display the ability to conduct a breeding program. Now, this ability to conduct a breeding program is not on how to breed a fish, like you take male and female and you breed. But this is when you want to produce some fish that has certain characters, there is a program that you need to do where you breed not only one pair of fish, but you breed 50 to 100 pairs of fish. So they learn how to manage selecting hundreds of fish, breeding, mass breeding, managing the progenies, and also selecting back the progenies. So this is what breeding program is all about. And they need to have the skill according to the standard procedure. And if you can see, the psychomotor level is P4. That means it's above then P3, a guided response, okay? And it is being delivered based on lab activities comprising 4 lab sessions. Now, I've been teaching this since 2006. So throughout my teaching, we always get comments and ask students. They have some feedbacks. And it came out in 2012 when I asked them. So in one of our, we call it, System Penilaian Pensyarah, ESPP in our UMT, student comment that latihan amali perlu diperbanyakkan. Okay. And another student also comment, banyakkan latihan amali. So another one also commented, okay, I understand more if I can do it practically. And one of the students also suggested, gunakan alat bantu mengajar. Contohnya, cube ataupun alatan yang dapat meningkatkan imajinasi untuk memahami genetik. And then this one, I still desired a practical lab. Okay, now, these are some of the comments, okay, from 100 comments. Now, let me show you, what do I need to have if I were to really increase their skills? Now, I need basically 4 fish ponds. One is the breeding pond, okay, and the blue one that you see here is called hapa, kelambu. These are considered as the room, hotel room. So the fish will go honeymoon here to breed, and you can see that you are not breeding one pair, you are breeding 100 pairs. So when you breed, you will have progenies, babies, so you need to nurse, and you cannot mix, because each pair, their siblings, their progeny, will need to be kept separately. So you need to have another pond. Now, when they grow up to a certain size, you need to test which one is better. This is especially for to see growth performance, which has the better growth. And those who attain good growth performance will be selected as the future broodstocks. So you need to have another broodstock ponds. So how many facilities do I need to have? Okay, and you can imagine how many fish that I need to buy in order for me to train students, because you are not dealing with one pair of fish. So there are certain issues in terms of cost. So what are the teaching materials that I need to buy, and how many facilities? Now, if you notice, if you keep the fish in the pond, we also have predators. Among them are otters. Okay, they can just come in, and it will be their feast. They can have a party, and they can just wipe out all your cultures within one day. Okay, I still remember last time when I went to USM to see Prof. Roshada. I think Prof. Roshada now is already, last time she is in USIM, but I don't know whether she's still there or not, Prof. Roshada. So we were discussing about nutrition for patin, kan patin. So she also told me that in USM, they are dealing with predators, biawak, in the hatcheries. So same goes with UMT. So just imagine, if you have a fish, you have these breeding facilities, how would the student continuously see the progress of learning if they are being stuck halfway, suddenly looking, there's no fish at all? And maintaining the fish sometimes will lead to some death and losses. And in my case, if I were to teach them, I will need to take about 6 to 8 months just to see one cycle of this breeding program. But to conduct breeding program, you need to have at least 6 to 8 generations. So if one generation takes about half a year, so you may need to have about 3 to 5 years to complete the full breeding program. So if you notice, it cannot be conducted within a semester. But students want it. They want to see the whole process of how to do this. Now, this is where the generation of ideas come in. So I developed a teaching kit. So based on the comments, looking at the issues, so come up with an idea. What if I develop a teaching kit? The idea comes from that student said, try to develop some kits for us to understand, to learn better. So I started to design the kit way back in 2013, right after, at the end of 2012, when I got these comments from the student. So we developed the kit, and the first trial was being done in the class activity. After that, we got feedback from the student, and we refine the learning instruction. Now, how to improve the learning instruction so that the student can follow the learning process properly. And it is implemented in lab practical class. The design has altered the running of the course, in which we introduce 4 lab classes related to using these kits. And in 2015 until now, the kit has also been used as part of their practical exam. So it is one way of alternative assessment. So this is the kit that I've developed. Okay, they call it Fish Breed Pro. It consists of all these things. It's a physical kit, right? So it first started to be implemented in a class. I just do a trial to see how is their response. Okay, just doing inside the class, you can see that they clear up all the chairs, sit down, and initially I just use a Manila card to represent the pawns. So it started off just like if you see the videos, the Panji FC videos, how they develop this football field. Now, these are the feedback that I got from the student. See, they are more confident to solve questions about breeding design. Okay. They understand better because now they see the whole process of doing the breeding program and it cuts off time. Okay, memahami breeding program dengan cara yang sangat mudah. Okay, and dengan board game secara pantas yang memberikan pemahaman yang tinggi. So, having that increase their understanding compared to just giving lectures. Now, previously, before I have the kids, in order for them to learn on how to do this breeding program, I give them assignment. So they need to come up with a proposal. But again, just having this proposal, how can they see the bigger picture if they don't really see how the thing is being done? But the best part is some of the students, they were so confident that they give this comment to me. So I'm happy to hear this because this is the ultimate goal. When you are able to have students so confident because they acquire the knowledge very well. Now, after this, it has transformed the implementation into practical. So I convert the practical session into 4 practical activities. Okay. So this comes by having the kit. And it is being implemented in 2014. So you can see the difference now. It really looks like a pawn, okay, compared to the Manila card that previously being done. So if you can see from the picture, they learn by doing, involves cooperative learning, peer learning occurs where those who understand will explain to the group members who don't understand. And along the way, through the instructional learning materials that I created, it also increased their critical thinking and problem-solving skills. So how it is implemented in teaching and learning? So at the beginning, I started off with doing a flipped classroom. So this is where I didn't give lectures. I will give them article, a report, breeding, technical breeding program report. They need to discuss among their group members, and during the class, each group needs to present. Okay, and I monitor their understanding based on formative assessment. Now, after that, they need to go through 4 laboratory activities. It's a mixture of using the kit as well as doing practical in the hatchery. So first, they learn about how to manage the parent, okay, the male and female, the pengantin, I can call it. Second, how to matchmake. This is what I call a wedding planner. How to matchmake all this, the parent. And then when you get the progeny, how do you manage? And how do you evaluate the performance? And how do you select the future parents to produce the next generation? So this whole complete process ends up takes about 6 weeks. Compared to if they want to see the whole actual picture, it will take about 6 months. So in the hands-on practical session, it is also being done based on simulation-based learning. You can see that they are doing in a small scale, simulated scale, compared to doing on the large scale like the one that you can see in the pond. Okay? So a lot of collaborative work, a lot of discussion, okay, apart from just increasing their skills, hands-on skill. In this thing, they learn about how to inject chips. I call it as an identification card for the fish, because the fish cannot talk. If you ask them, they cannot tell their name. They cannot tell their origin. So you need to track them by putting some chip so that when you scan, they will come up this IC number. Okay, what they do really simulates that. Now, again, as I said, it is not about the skill on breeding the fish. It is the skill of how to make the fish. So when they have a fish having a different code number, IC number, so how do they match make? And the design of the game really simulates the environment in the pond. So in 2015, again, trying to figure out ideas, since now I have the kids, so how do I measure? Okay, how do I assess their learning? Do they really obtain the things that they should learn? So again, idea comes in, you need to figure out how to do assessment, okay, in which you are not just asking them to muntahkan balik apa yang mereka belajar. So I need to initially, and then now feature inside that. So from here, I can monitor, we can know whether the student is able to run a breeding program for this fish breeding program. Now, based on this, the kit allows me to identify weak students, and it allows me to conduct intervention program. So those who are still unable to understand, so there will be another session in which I will attend to them. It will take about 1 to 2 hour session to explain to them back again and to answer any inquiries, confusion that they have. Now, the kit doesn't stop there. This is what I said. How does the impact or the progress of this thing started off from the command coming from the student, and how does it progress? Since having the kit allows me to conduct training to farmers. So last time, I have the chance to work together with a college community, Jerantut. So we conduct a course, Kursus Penghasilan Bakar Baharu Ikan. So using this kit allows me to train irregardless of anywhere they are. So it does not necessarily mean that they must be conducted in a fish pond. It can also be conducted in a classroom setting. So here the farmers will learn on how to manage the breeding program, okay, in order to produce better quality fish. But then, if you notice, these are all face-to-face, hands-on, practical. When the pandemic comes, again, issues crops up. You cannot conduct them face-to-face. So challenge comes in when you need to do all this thing to achieve the learning outcome online. So the challenges in how do I ensure through online learning, students still attain the intended learning outcome. Second, knowing about online learning, how do I increase student engagement? Because they don't open their cameras, you don't know what they are doing, but how do you increase their engagement? And the third one, since they are sitting remotely, how do you ensure collaboration can be done? And since you need to be flexible, okay, you cannot be too rigid to them because they are also attending other class. So how do you figure out a way in which your method will allow ownership of learning to the students? So based on this, again, ideas need to come in. This is where I implemented the use of Google. So that is why just now I said, I'm not using Mentimeter, I'm not using Padlet, I'm using Google, because there is a reason that I would like to explain further regarding that. Now, having Google allows me to use this platform for my teaching and learning. One of the things that I use is Google Slide. Anybody here have used Google Slide before? If you can respond. Okay. So normally we use PowerPoints, but again, you have Google Slide. But Google Slide, okay, for those of you who have never used before, Google Slide is like a PowerPoint. Okay, it's like a PowerPoint, but it is under Google. So you prepare your presentation, your slides, just like what I'm presenting, but now I'm using PowerPoint. I didn't use Google Slide. Okay. Now, where does this innovation comes in when using Google Slide? This is what I want to show you. Previously, when I created the kit, that is called radical innovation. Now, how do I improve the current one? So this is where what I can say as incremental innovation. You have Google Slide. Google Slide is used for preparing like a PowerPoint slide, but I turn this into an interactive board game. So to implement them in teaching and learning, I need to design back the learning instruction, but it gives a more learner experience compared to just using the physical kits. So now, having this online, the development of the online breeding facilities are being developed by the students themselves. This is why I said ownership of learning. Previously, having the kits, I designed the kit. So they just come in, okay, now this is the step number one. You need to do this. But now, you give the freedom. You need to develop a facilities. Discuss with your group members. Design your own breeding facilities. So they design their own. I'll show you an example afterward. And then they need to do practical labs. But I do practical labs online. So we observe and monitor. And they need to do reflection. So again, using simulation-based learning. So just now, one participant asking me, how do you develop new teaching method? That's why understanding of the learning strategies. A lot of my teaching and learning activities in applied sciences is based on simulation-based learning. So this is the outcome, right? Okay, let us stop here. Let us go to Google and I show to you. All right. So I use a lot of Google platform. I created two things, okay, which is previously a physical kits. Okay, this is the group member. Okay, let us open one. Okay. So now, redesign back the teaching and learning using online learning. Each group needs to create a company. So this is the members of the company, group one. Okay. They have their own brood stocks, their own strains. Okay. And they show to us, okay, what are the breeding facilities that they have? And then through this lab session, okay, the first thing that they need to do is they need to design. Now, this is their design. Now, the size of this, the pond is not the normal A4 size. I give them to develop A1 poster size facilities. So you can see here, the pond is being designed by the students. So the ownership of learning, they use their creativity, they discuss among their colleagues, and they design their own breeding ponds. Okay, just like if you can see inside the video, having to build a football field at the sea gives some problems in terms of having the wet surface, making them slippery, but it allows them to acquire another skill. And when the times come when they play football during the rain, they become much better. So here, using online, they have the creativity to develop their own breeding facilities. And from here, they collaborate, okay, mixing and match okay, you can see here crossing the breed between different strains, okay. So these are being done using Google Slide. So Google Slide now is no more about doing a slide presentation, but it has become an interactive activity, okay, among the students. So the creative ideas of transforming Google Slide that is normally being used to prepare PowerPoint slides, now being used for online collaborative activities. But the good thing about having this is that once they have these breeding facilities, they can just copy and paste to develop more breeding facilities. So having this allows them to keep what they have done before, so they can revisit back later. And if we were to do a new one, they can just copy and paste the new pawn and to do a new activity. Okay. So you can see, while doing these activities, I can also chat using this Google platform. Inside this Google Slide, you have a chat section in which you can chat with the students. So monitoring becomes more effective compared to previously. You need to go all around the table, but now you just click. You can see here, during the online lab session, I can just monitor every group members. And we also know who are the members who attended this, and we know who are the ones who are doing this activity inside this Google Slide. Okay. So my initial finding of using this online, you can see that it assists in student engagement. Okay, it develops a new approach in lab activities through online learning. Okay, and the learning outcome can still be achieved. But again, because this is being done once, there is room for improvement to make it more effective. And in terms of classroom management, you can give timely feedback because you can just monitor and you know where they did the mistakes and you can explain to them again. Okay, so you have any question? Hopefully that you can see how these teaching and learning in applied science, where innovation is implemented in teaching and learning of applied science, in the process of innovating, starting from getting ideas, going through generating the idea to solve it, and then acting towards that idea, producing some products, and you see the impact by assessing, okay, the outcome of the activities. Okay, that is one thing that I would like to share. I hope that you can see the whole process of this, the use of creative thinking, design thinking in implementing teaching and learning innovation. So if you have any question, please feel free to do so. The fourth part, the second last part, I would like to show some examples. Now, I'm not very innovative enough, but I want to do some creative things. So can I still do it? So this might be some of the question that crops up. So it will take a long time if I were to do some innovation. Can't there be any quick solution to do this? So the fourth part is where I would like to show some example. Okay. I proceed this because there's one activity that I would like you to try. Now, if you don't have anything, but you like to try a new one, you can have a look about the current products that is available. Okay, one, whether you have any existing teaching kits or model. If you don't have, then you can create. If not, you can use the existing one. You can see that in applied science, there are some computer simulation. This is what, after this, I would like participants to experience. If you haven't tested this before, a computer simulation, maybe you can use this to in your teaching and learning activity. Augmented reality, virtual reality, use of robots. I know one in UKM where this lecturer used robots to teach medical students. Yeah, and you can also use simulator. Okay. Now, in my case, okay, let us go into this one. Virtual interactive bacteria laboratory. Okay, I would like to copy this, we take some time to try this. Okay. Let me stop sharing this. Okay, I will put this inside the chat. All right. So, I hope participants will try. Okay, for those of you who may not, or maybe just following using handphones or what. Okay, I will show you one example. Now, this is a virtual interactive bacteriology laboratory. Okay, for those of you who are trying to do this, can you respond whether you can access this website? All right, thank you, Natalie. Okay, so if you don't have any kids, any method you can try using existing tools that has been developed. Okay, you may not have novelty or originality, but you do some innovation in terms of your teaching and learning, because you transform how you do things. Previously, you do this way, but now you are using existing technology for other purposes. Okay, let us do strict plate. Okay, click on this strict plate. This is a simple exercise. Okay, I'm here already, strict plate. You see, it has given instruction. There is a module. So I go to the module. Description, the steps, everything. So if you click on the step, it will explain what you need to do. Okay? Step number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. You see that when you create this instruction, this is one of the ways where you develop ownership of the learning. The student can set their own time on how to do it. Either they can do it during the lab session, or they can repeatedly do it at any time that they want. Okay? Now go back to the menu. Okay. I will start. Okay. So first you need to pick up. So how do you know that you pick up the right things? If you hover your mouse to the wrong equipment, orange color won't light up. So you pick up. Okay. Then you see you move. That means it is not correct. Where should you move it? You need to go here. Then normally you need to heat up the loop to kill any existing bacteria. After this, you see, how do I know which step orange colored comes in? So it asks you to pick a colony. A colony means one single thing. What happened if I pick up here? See, an instruction comes out. You need to pick an isolated colony. So, okay, this is an isolated colony. All right. Finish this. Where should I go? Here. So you click and then you streak. You see, you just like you are doing it in the lab. Okay, done. Need to reheat back. You need to continue on the next slide, next column. And then you heat up. Now, I will make a mistake just now to see what happened. What will it come out? Okay. If you straight away here, you see, you click on the wrong quadrant. So you need to continue from here. If I move over here, see, you drag into the wrong quadrant. It is so detailed, simulates the actual learning process, that you can really learn on how to streak a bacteria on a plate. Okay, now I'm going to my last part. Okay, so take from here. Oh, cannot. Oh, you drag out of quadrant 3. How can we measure the level of ability to perform the action? Okay, wait. Let me finish this one, okay? Oh. Okay. Now, how can we measure the level of ability to perform the action as long as it is, yes, because they can screenshot what they do. So, one more thing, who is asking me? Let me check. Okay, Dr. Hafzan, the first thing that you need to bear in mind is, what is the level of skill set that you want? If the level of skill set is, for example, level 2, psychomotor level 2, then as long as they can display they are doing the right thing, then that is how you measure. Okay? Another thing is, what is the intended objective that you want to achieve from here? So, the measurement of the level depends on the purpose of you using this tool for student teaching and learning. So, if, for example, you just want them to experience how it is being done, so as long as it is accomplished, okay. The second, maybe if you want to ensure that they are very skillful, maybe you can modify your assessment in terms of how many pop-up arise when they do it. If the pop-up comes up more than 5, that means the marks will be a little bit lower. So this is how you play around designing your implementation of teaching and learning. I hope I answered your question. So you can see the results, okay, on how you streak a plate. Okay. All right. Anybody has inside this group or participant has tested this just now or still testing? Please give comment. How do you find it? So try to find some existing tools that is related to your field, okay? And then you see whether that tools allows the student to learn up until to what level that they can achieve. So this is implementing the existing technique, okay? All right, a few minutes more. So I want to go into another one. Okay, let me share this. All right, this is one apps that I downloaded from App Store. Yes, correct. Let me tell you, when I develop online assessment for my Google slide, I need to postpone the exam because I thought setting up the individual exam sheet will take about 1 to 2 hours. It took me one whole day to do the assessment. What I mean is this one. Okay, I share back this Google. You know when I conducted, this activity, okay, where the student in a group created their facilities. Okay, just to show you the second group, okay, what they did. This is the second group. This is the company, company profile. Okay. This is Japan. You can see how each group is very creative in designing their own ponds. Okay, but what another thing that I would like to highlight is this one. When we develop this, so how do I assess the students? See, we conducted ujian amali. I need to design so that the student will have different sets of questions. So there is session 1, session 1A, session 2. So you can see, can you see the list of the files here? Now, this is the list of the files that I need to create for each student since they need to do the assessment individually. So setting up this thing takes a very long time. It took me about one whole day to set this until I need to postpone the exam. Can we do it tomorrow? But again, I say initial, starting from zero takes a long time. But after that, if I were to conduct this again, it will not, the time that I consume will not be as long as the first time that I conduct this. Okay, just to open you one. So having this, then how do you need to create? So each set has its own question. So the student will have different sets of questions. So it eliminates them from copying. So we need to monitor how they conduct inside here. Well, I think I copied the original file. I show it to you. Oh yeah, because it's not shared. Okay, you see how many sets that I need to create? Right? Okay, so the file are being shared to each individual. And then they can only conduct the exam. Okay, now I'm going back here, a little bit more to finish. This is a game. I found it in Apple, using Apple. The name of the game is Aquaculto. So I'm teaching one subject, fishery science. And in that subject, we expose students about aquaculture. Yes, the activity, the software, the apps is free. Dr. Nusakinah, the app is free. The student need not pay. So they download it. I use it as a game. You see, from this game, they will try to expand their cage. The more you expand your cage, and then they manage. You build up the cage. After a certain time, the signal will come, okay, fish ready to be harvested. So you need to click at this pond at this cage, then money comes in. You see here, oh, this is where the money. So once you develop the money, you increase, okay, you gain a lot of money, then at a certain stage, you are allowed to build a facilities. So when I tried this game, I was able to, at this time, build a genetic laboratory activity lab. Okay, so again, you can purchase fishing vessels. You can see here, quantity of fish. You set your own quantity, how much. But based on the setting, you will be told what are the risks that you will face. For example, if you say that I need to put 100 fish, the cage, the duration, the ketahanan of the cage will be reduced. So that means instead of you are able to use the cage for 10 times, you are only able to use for 6 times. So you choose whether you want to put lower fish, but you can use it many times, or you can put it higher number of fish, increase the intensity, but in long term, the cost of need to buy a new cage increase. So this is how the student learn about aquaculture, managing aquaculture. So each stage that they achieve, they will get this achievement. So this is another way of you can implement in your applied science subject. So find any games that you can see either in a Google Play Store or in Apple that you can use them for your teaching and learning. This is the very basic starting point. I want to innovate. I don't have any ideas to create something, but how about I'm using existing tools? By all means, use it and design your learning instruction. I noticed Associate Professor Dr. Azida also attended this. Thank you very much. You are all grateful because Dr. Azida is very expert in learning instruction. Okay, what call it? Not learning instruction, instructional design. Please consult her if you want to develop your instructional design for your teaching and learning. She is very expert. You all very grateful to have her in USM. So from there, you can have some assistance on designing it and implement, and you test whether it gives an impact or not. Okay, this is one of the kits that also developed, but I don't want to explain further because the process of development is the same. Right? Dr. Zida, you're kena seru. Okay. This is physical, but again, I transformed them using Google Slide to become an interactive lab activities. So I also use the kit to teach farmers. Again, we collaborate with College Community Jerantut. So we conduct Khusus Genetik Ikan Laga. These are all breeders, okay? Beta fish breeders, and they learn about genetics using my kits. Another one that I'm developing, but still it's not very final, it's still in the developing stage, is how I get the students to understand about taxonomy. You can see here that normally we bring students to the field so that they can learn about fish. Okay, they need to understand the species, the class, the order, the taxonomic order of the fish. But we have problems because if they want to learn repetitively, then we need to purchase a lot of fish. It involves costs. So I designed a card. Okay. So from here, the student working collaboratively to classify the fish. So they arrange them according to the order, according to the family. Okay. And they learn from each other. And now currently, I'm converting this into online. Hope to implement this next diploma session in August, right? This is during the before pandemic, but now I'm trying to convert this because I notice when you do online, just like if some of you have experienced that bacterial streak plate, students can do it again and again, so it increases their understanding. Now, for this case, the level is very low. Cognitive level 2, understanding. Because this subject is offered for first-year student during first semester, just to get them to understand about fish. Okay? Another one. This is by my colleague. She created this board game on teaching students to understand about aquaculture biotechnology. So this is the kit that she created. and implementing QR code, augmented reality, and the student learn the process of doing DNA analysis. Okay, they have the steps. She designed the learning instruction, and the student follow this. Okay, so you can see there's the impact is very great. Increase in students' understanding skills, they become more confident, and you develop a lot of teaching and learning materials, and it transforms some of the lab activities, assessment instrument, and in terms of management, less cost, a very reduction in time, and also low risk. Okay, and now we go to the summary, but I'd like to answer this. Okay, Dr. Hafzan, inshallah, if I have the time, now we have come to the end, but I will be glad to share how I designed this based on my experience, tailored the learning instruction, the development of the method to tailor to the SLT, student learning time, and also tailored to the learning outcome as well as the learning outcome level. Because as you know, there are some cognitive level 4 that you need to attain. Some is only level 2. All right, since our student tends to comment that they were using more time for certain activities. Yes. I would be glad to share, but maybe I contact you personally if you can email to me, then I can discuss with you further. I would be glad to have some discussion. Okay. So coming to the end of it, what I can summarize is, again, we go back to the aim of innovation. Especially in teaching and learning. The aim is to improve the quality in teaching and learning approach for student learning. This is our ultimate aim. So it is not solely about commercialization, IPs or patent. I don't deny it. It's very important. But our main area is the first thing that you need to achieve, whether this innovation really improves the quality in the teaching and learning approach for student learning. Okay. Second, you can see that innovation need not be high-tech. I've shown to you an example of high technology, software. Some, you just develop the method. Okay, forgot to convert this. So innovation needs to be continued. There is CQI, continuous quality improvement. But all these things cannot be done if you don't equip yourself with proper knowledge. Or if you don't have knowledge, find somebody, discuss with somebody that has the knowledge. As I told you just now, if you have some ideas, but you don't have the skills to design the learning instruction, you can contact your colleagues. Like for example, Dr. Azida, she may assist you in giving suggestion on how to construct the learning instruction. And the final and most important thing, you must ensure anything that you do is not merely for the sake of having fun in the classroom, but the attainment of the student learning outcome. Because you do this to solve problems, issues that relates to the student learning, right? Once you attain, the student get excited because they acquire the knowledge, learning will become fun to them. And the last thing that I would like to highlight, some points to ponder. There is also a need for me to point out the need for research and development. You can see development of the kits, development of methods. It needs to be research. So for those who are following teaching track, SOTL, then this might be one of the way for you to embark in your research. I would like to share one of UMT experience where 2 years ago, UMT allocate some funds for subtle research. Each individual receive about between 5,000 to 8,000 ringgit to kickstart their research in teaching and learning. Okay. Another thing is the content creation and development. You can see that there are a lot of possibilities where you can create content, your existing content, into a different way to enhance and make the teaching and learning more effective. And you can, if you can see, when I showed to you the use of software, like for me, I'm a fisheries guy. I don't have the knowledge in computing, okay, computer science. So, but I have the ideas that I need to develop some software. So cross-disciplinary research and collaboration needs to be established so that those who are in the applied science can work together with the respected parties. If you want to develop software or apps, maybe you need to collaborate with people in engineering or people in computer science, as well as funding. Just to show to you, I just throw out this idea. I don't mind if anybody can develop this, because I will be the first one to use. You see, sharing you this because to show the importance of having the process of innovation, getting the ideas, and then trying to see the action to implement the ideas to produce a product. You know, when we do breeding, there is one method where we do it, what we call as artificial breeding. You strip out the eggs from the female, transfer them into a bowl, and you strip out the sperm of the male and mix it up. So you do artificial breeding. Now, if we were to train students, the student needs to practice on how to picit perut ikan tu. If you put too much pressure, you will damage the internal structure of the fish. Sometimes blood can come out. Okay? But if you want the student to practice over and over again, how many fish you need? Kan? You just imagine, asyik kena picit je perut. Picit kan? Muntah ikan tu. Kan? And how, what the cost of buying a lot of fish for the student to practice, because we are not dealing with one student. We are dealing with 40, 50, 80 students. But what if we can develop a model fish that resembles like a fish and has a pressure sensor inside there, where the student, when they put up a pressure at the fish abdomen, the meter will come out. What is the amount of pressure that you use? And it simulates. When we do a study, when we simulate that, okay, in order to get the eggs out, there are a certain pressure that you need to have. So by having this simulated model, maybe the student can learn on putting the right pressure, repeatedly doing it, and gain the skills. So you see, I have this idea, but I don't have the skills to develop this. So we need to collaborate with engineers. Only engineering people has the skill to develop all these things. This is what I'm trying to show to you, why cross-disciplinary research and collaboration to develop teaching and learning tools is needed. And of course, we need funds of it. So finally, to share with you, don't forget to dream big. Think big, start small. You can look at the video just now, okay? Yeah, you can look at what I developed, starting small, but you need to act now. And the importance of starting it slowly and at a smaller step. Okay, you achieve it one by one. Like in my case, it took for me about, I think, 4 years to develop the method. Okay, keep on improving. And now, it's still not, it doesn't stop there. I need to evolve, transform it into online. Okay, so the improvement is continuous. But you do it slowly. So finally, I would like to thank all of you for still here with me, joining me in this session. Thank you for your participation. And I would like to thank the Ministry of Higher Education for providing me the universities, the courses, okay, allowing us to having the course to teach, okay. Also, CDAE for inviting me for this session. All right. So that's all for me. All the best to all of you. I hope that for those who haven't started any innovation, this session can spark some ideas for you to start off. And I'll be happy to discuss anything. Please contact me. Okay, so that is all from me. Thank you very much, Ulu Setia, Puan Noliza, Puan Ruzana. Okay, everybody. Assalamualaikum. So if you have any question, please do so. That's all from me.
Okay, maybe if the participants have any question, you can contact Dr. Shariza through email.
Yes.
So terima kasih banyak Dr. Shariza daripada CDAE. Terima kasih banyak atas curahan ilmu pagi ini. Sangat informatif, banyak panduan dan idea yang Dr. Shariza kongsikan dan diharapkan dapat dimanfaatkan oleh semua peserta pagi ini. To our participants, thank you very much and we hope to see you again in future webinars. So as usual, please record your attendance and complete the survey form. So the link is in the chat box.
Sorry. Yeah? Yeah. Saya nak bagi ni, saya tertinggal pula. Saya masuk dalam link ni, this notes, nota ni.
Okay.
Saya put kat sini.
Okay, no problem, thank you.
Okay.
Okay, cantik.
So this is the notes for my talk just now.
Okay, alhamdulillah, terima kasih. So terima kasih dah banyak Dr. Shariza sekali lagi. Hopefully we'll see you in future webinars. Yeah?
Okay, thank you very much. InsyaAllah.
Okay, Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi.
Salam.
Terima kasih Dr. Shariza.
Sama-sama.
I need a girl like you, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I need a girl like you, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I need a girl like you, yeah. I spent last night on a last flight to you. Took a whole day of trying to get ready.